But standing by the cross of Jesus, Mary, his mother, and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Philopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and his disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to his disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said to fulfill the scripture, "I thirst." A jar full of sour wine stood there, so they put a sponge full of sour wine on a hyssop branch, and he held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And he bestowed, and he bowed his head and gave up the spirit. Thank you.
Estaban juntos a la cruz de Jesús su madre y la hermana de su madre, María, mujer de Cleofás, y María Magdalena. Cuando vio a Jesús a su madre y al discípulo a quien él amaba que estaba presente, dijo a su madre, "Mujer, he aquí tu hijo." Después dijo al discípulo, "He aquí tu madre." Y desde aquella hora el discípulo la recibió en su casa. Después de esto, sabiendo Jesús que ya todo estaba consumado, dijo, para que la escritura se cumpliese, "Tengo sed." Y estaba allí una vasija llena de vinagre. Entonces ellos empaparon en vinagre una esponja y poniéndola en un hisopo, se le acercaron a la boca. Cuando Jesús hubo tomado el vinagre, dijo, "Consumado es." Y habiendo inclinado la cabeza, entregó el espíritu.
Gracias. El mismo autor de este libro, Juan, también escribió el libro de Apocalipsis. The same author that wrote this Gospel of John also wrote the book of Revelation. En el libro de Apocalipsis, Juan tuvo una visión de dos imágenes de Jesús, que describe perfectamente lo que Juan vio en la cruz en Jesús aquí. There's two images that John sees in a vision in Revelation that perfectly describe what I think John sees in the cross of Jesus right here. So if you'll go with me, I want to show you this in Revelation. Ve conmigo, Apocalipsis 5:5-6. This is Revelation 5:5-6. Apocalipsis 5:5-6. Vamos a ver dos imágenes de Jesús que describen lo que Juan vio en Jesús en la cruz. Revelation 5:5-6. Necesitas entender el contexto. Juan estaba en el trono llorando porque nadie podía abrir el rollo de siete sellos. You need to understand the context here. John is weeping before the throne. There's nobody that's found that can open the roll of the scroll with seven seals. Pero en versículo 5 dice, uno de los ancianos me dijo, "Deja de llorar, que ya el león de la tribu de Judá, la raíz de David, ha vencido." One of the elders came to him and said, "Stop crying. Weep not. The lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has conquered. Él si puede abrir el rollo de sus siete sellos." Entonces vi en medio de los cuatro seres vivientes del trono y los ancianos a un cordero que estaba de pie y parecía haber sido sacrificado. So I saw in the middle of the four living creatures of the throne and of the elders, there was a lamb standing, looking as if he had been slain. Dos imágenes. There's two images here. Un león y un cordero. Jesús es el león en su poder, su autoridad, su soberanía sobre todo el universo. Jesus is a lion in the way that he rules and reigns, his power and authority and his unique sovereignty over all of the creative order. Pero a la misma vez, Jesús es un cordero en su compasión, su misericordia, su ternura, su simpatía. But also Jesus is a lamb. At the same time, having the authority and power of a lion, he's a lamb in his compassion, in his mercy, in his tenderness, and in his sympathy. Eso es lo que vamos a ver hoy. This is what we're going to see today. Jesús como un león en su soberanía divina. This is Jesus like a lion in his divine sovereignty. Pero como un cordero en su simpatía infinita. But like a lamb in his infinite sympathy to a woman right there by the cross. Ustedes ya saben lo que hemos estado, ustedes ya saben lo que hemos estado viviendo lo que hemos estado contemplando aquí en Juan 19. You all already know what we've been beholding here in John 19. Hemos visto la gloria de Jesús en la cruz. We have seen the glory of Jesus in the cross. ¿Cuántos de ustedes saben que en la cruz es el centro ardiente de la gloria de Dios? How many of you know when the cross is the center of the glory of God? How many of you know that? Si ustedes no saben eso, esa mañana van a saberlo. If you don't know this morning, then you're going to know this morning. La cruz es como un diamante. De cada lado es brillante. La cruz es repleta con la gloria de Jesús de cada lado. You can see in every, just like in a diamond, you see from every side the brilliance of this diamond. In the cross, you see something replete with the glory of Jesus at every side. Así que, hemos visto la gloria de Jesús en su cumplimiento de la Escritura aquí en la cruz. Y hemos visto la gloria de Jesús en el letrero que Pilato puso sobre la cruz. What have we seen thus far? We've seen the fulfillment of Scripture and the glory of Jesus in that, in the cross. And we've also seen the glory of Jesus in the sign that he put over the cross, that Pilate put over the cross. Hoy, yo quiero que veamos la gloria de Jesús en su soberanía y simpatía. So, just this is what I want you to walk away with, okay? Like, what's the point? Here's the point. I want you to walk away with the glory of Jesus and his sovereignty and his sympathy. Sovereignty. Bueno, aquí es la escena. Here's the scene. Jesús está colgado en la cruz. Jesus is hanging on the cross. Al lado de la cruz son cuatro personas, cuatro discípulos. You've got four people that are standing right here by the cross. Juan, María Magdalena, María la esposa de Cleopas, y María su madre. You've got John, Mary his mother, Mary Magdalene, and Mary the wife of Cleopas. How many of you are mothers? ¿Cuántos de ustedes son padres? Levanta la mano. How many? You raise my real hand. Levanta. What? Madre. Imagínate, madre. I just want you to imagine this. Estás enfrente de la cruz. Verán como ellos están crucificando su hijo. I want you to just imagine. You're standing there in front of the cross as they're crucifying the son you raised. Enfrente de tus ojos. Ellos han golpeado a él, crucificado a él. Él ahora es sangriente. Ellos han azotado como un trozo de carne y ahora él está colgado en una cruz. Imagínate, Jessica, que you've seen him get beaten like a piece of meat. They shoved a crown of thorns onto his head. They whipped him and put him on a cross, ripping the ligaments and joints out of socket, and now he's hanging there, crying out, and you're the mother. Imagínate. Lo increíble es que María ya sabía que eso pasará. Mary already knew that this was going to happen. Well, how did she know that? ¿Tú recuerdas cuando ellos presentaron a Jesús en el templo? You remember, they presented Jesus in the temple. Hubo un hombre allá, se llama Simeón, que dijo sobre el niño y sobre su vida. El profetizó. There was a guy there named Simeon. What did he say? What did Simeon say about Jesus? What was going to happen? You might remember? Bueno, Lucas 2. Mira Lucas 2, 34 a 35. I want you to look at Luke 2, 34 to 35. Él dijo, Simeón, he aquí este niño ha sido puesto para la caída y el levantamiento de muchos en Israel, para ser señal de contradicción, y mirando a María, y una espada traspasará aún tu propia alma. Simeon looks at Jesus, blesses him, and says to his mother Mary, this child has been given for the rise and the fall of many in Israel to be a sign of contradiction. And he says, and a sword will pierce your own soul. Ahora, enfrente de la cruz, una espada está traspasando su propia alma. This is when it happens. Literally, a sword is piercing her soul as she watches the son that she raised die. Now, mothers, look at me again. Mothers, mira. Imagínate. Can you imagine this? Jesús está colgado en la cruz y aquí tres mujeres y un hombre. Bueno, así que no sorprendente que María está allá en la cruz. It's not surprising to us that Mary is there. Pero ¿sabes qué? Solo hay cuatro personas. There's only four people with Jesus. ¿Cuántos son mujeres? How many of them are women? Tres mujeres. ¿Dónde están los hombres? Where's all the guys? Hiding. Escondiéndose. Mire, ¿sabes qué? Se necesitaba mucho coraje para estar allá en la cruz con alguien que están ejecutando. ¿Por qué? Ellos pueden hacer lo mismo a ti. You know, it's pretty dangerous to be there when they're executing somebody and you're associated with them. It takes a lot of courage, actually. So I want to know, why are the women there? ¿Por qué están allá las mujeres? No María, porque ya entendemos eso. Pero, ¿por qué están allá las mujeres? Why are the women there? Risking their life. It's real simple. Yo creo que es sencillo. Ellas amaban a Jesus. They loved him. They really loved Jesus. You don't know why? En una cultura en que las mujeres eran denigradas, Jesús sabía cómo tratar a una mujer. Escúchame bien. Especialmente uno. In a culture where women were denigrated and dishonored, Jesus knew how to treat women. Did he not? Now, I'm going to tell you something. This is not the point at all, this passage. Okay? So I give that to you as a disclaimer. But guys, we got about a lot of young guys here today. Guys, the way you treat a woman says a lot about your character. Amen, Romy? Somebody. Hombres, la forma en que tratamos a mujeres dice mucho acerca de nuestro carácter. Ellos están allá porque Jesús sabía cómo honrar, cuidar de las mujeres. Jesus knew how to honor them. Jesus knew how to care for them. Y ahora Él va a mostrar la simpatía divina a ella, a su madre. Jesus is about to show divine sympathy to this lady who's struggling. On the cross, folks. Now, I want you to see something here that I think is not funny, but it could be. Okay? Mira aquí. Dice, junto a la cruz de Jesús estaba su madre, la hermana de su madre y todos ellos. Y cuando Jesús vio a su madre y al discípulo quien era amaba que estaba ahí, dijo a su madre, mujer. So Jesus looks at his mother, okay? What's her name? What is her name? Her name is Mary. Does he say her name? Does he say her name? Dijo su nombre. ¿Qué dijo?
Woman.
Why do you say woman? Does Jesus not respect women? We just said Jesus knows how to treat women. Does he now not respect women? No. No es una falta de respeto. This is not a lack of respect. Lo que Jesús está diciendo aquí es decir, nuestra relación ha cambiado. He's telling her, watch this now, Mary. Our relationship has now changed. In fact, it changed 3 years ago when I started my ministry. How do I know that? Everybody go to John 2. Mira Juan 2. Juan 2. Recuerda, ellos están en la boda en Caná de Galilea. They're in the wedding in the Cana of Galilee. ¿Y qué pasó? ¿Qué pasó en la boda? Ven, ¿qué pasó en la boda?
María dijo que ya estaba viendo
el vino. El vino se acabó. So, what happened at the wedding? The wine ran out. Now, here's what Mary's thinking. My son can take care of this. Mi hijo puede arreglar esa situación. Él tiene el poder. Así que, Jesús, ¿puedes hacer algo? So she goes over to Jesus, and what she said? Hey, can you do something about this? We ran out of wine. And Jesus says, okay. Jesús dijo, sí, está bien. ¿Eso es lo que yo digo? No, ¿qué digo? Mujer, eso que tiene que ver conmigo. Y ahora no ha llegado. He says to her, hey, woman, what does this have to do with me? My hour's not come. En otras palabras, María, tú no puedes usar tu relación conmigo, la relación física de madre a hijo, para hacerme usar mi poder. Mary, you can't use your physical relationship with me from mother to son to make me do something with my power. María, estás en el mismo nivel con cada otra mujer que necesita mi gracia en cuanto a las cosas del reino de Dios. Yo escucho a una voz y una voz solamente la voz de mi padre. What voice does Jesus listen to when it comes to the kingdom of God? Not his mother's voice. He listens to his father's voice. And she, just like everybody else, every other woman needs grace. Now I want to tell you something. Here's an application. Mary is not in heaven telling Jesus what to do. María no está en el cielo diciendo a Jesús que lo que hace. Como ella tiene una influencia grande sobre él, lo que creen muchos en nuestro futuro. Ella está en el mismo nivel con cada otra mujer. She is there on the same level with every other woman. She does not tell Jesus what to do. So look again at John 19. Juan 19. Mujer. Ella y tu hijo. Jesús está en punto de entrar en su reino. Él dice, María, nuestra relación no es madre al hijo, es niña a Dios. ¿Me entiendes?
He's saying to her, Mary, listen to me. Our relationship now is not mother to son. Our relationship is child to God. Tú necesitas que yo provea tus necesidades, no al opuesto. You need me to provide your needs, not the other way around. Do you get that? ¿Todos entienden eso? Mujer, he ahí tu hijo. Vamos a ver la gloria de Jesús en ver su tierra, compasión, ternura por sus ovejas. I want you to see this. So their relationship has changed, and now she's God providing her. Right? Now he's God providing her. Ahora él es Dios proveyendo por ella. Su relación ha cambiado. No es madre hijo, es Dios niño. Y parte de ver su gloria es ver su ternura, su compasión por ella, al mismo tiempo que él está colgado en la cruz. It's seeing the fact that he was sympathetic towards her, compassionate towards her, while he's sitting there getting nailed. He's on the cross, thinking about her. Sangriento, golpeado, crucificado con un dolor inimaginable. Can you imagine bleeding out of every possible spot? Beaten, crucified, and he's caring for her. That's the glory of Jesus. This is our glory today. En contraste con la crueldad de los soldados, los romanos, los judíos, Pilato, Caifás, vemos el amor de Jesús. This is a big contrast, isn't it? With the cruelty of Pilate and Caiaphas and all the Romans and all the Jewish Sanhedrin and everybody that put him there. It's a contrast to see the love of Jesus. Now, I want you to listen to what John 13:1 said. Eso es Juan 13:1. Me recuerdo cuando Ben predicaba este pasaje. Ben preached this passage, John 13:1. Just listen to what it says. Sabiendo Jesús que su hora había llegado para pasar de este mundo al Padre, habiendo amado a los suyos que estaban en el mundo, los amó hasta el fin. For the Passover feast, knowing that his hour had come, he was about to pass from this world to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, watch what it says, he loved them until the end. What's he doing? Está amando los suyos hasta el fin. Hasta el fin. He's loving his own until the end. That's what he's doing. Listen to what this says. Listen to Matthew 12:20. It's Mateo 12:20. No quebrará la caña cascada, ni apagará la mecha que humea. He will not break a broken reed, nor quench a smoldering wick. What does that mean? Jesus is tender with broken people. Jesús es tierno con personas quebrantadas. Esa mujer no tiene nada. Mary doesn't have anybody. ¿Dónde está su esposo? Where's Joseph? Where? He's dead. ¿Dónde están los otros niños? Where's all the other brothers? En Galilea. They're all in Galilee. Muchos de ellos no creyeron en Jesús. Así que ahora, el niño, el hijo que había cuidado de ella, ahora él está a punto de morir. So the one who has cared for her, the one who's taken care of her while all the rest of the family has gone either through death or whatever other reason, he's the one that's cared for her. She has nobody. Now, Jesús va a proveer. ¿Ustedes recuerdan cuando Jesús estaba hablando con Pedro después de hablar con el joven rico? ¿Ustedes recuerdan la historia del joven rico? You all remember the story of the rich young ruler? Raise your hand if you do. Okay, good. All right. People remember this one. Ustedes recuerdan la historia. Después del joven rico se fue, Pedro estaba hablando con Jesús y él dijo, hemos dejado todo para seguirte. Con confianza, Pedro. Peter looks at Jesus and he says, hey, Jesus, you know what? That guy that just left, sorry about that, but we've left everything to follow you. Here's Jesus' response. Aquí es la respuesta de Jesús. Y vamos a conectarlo con lo que él está haciendo para María. Here's Jesus' response. We're going to connect it to what he's doing for Mary. This one is it. En verdad os digo, no hay nadie que haya dejado casa, o hermanos, o hermanas, o madre, o padre, o hijos, o tierras, por causa de mí, por causa del Evangelio, que no recibe 100 veces más ahora en este tiempo, casas, y hermanos, y hermanas, y madres, y hijos, y tierras, junto con persecuciones, y en el siglo venidero, la vida eterna. Jesus says, truly I say to you, nobody who has left house, or brothers, or sisters, or mother, or father, or children, or land, for my sake, and for sake of the gospel, will fail to receive 100 times in this life houses, brothers, sisters, mothers, sons, and lands, together with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. How's he going to provide that right now?
¿Cómo va a proveer una familia ahora para los que han perdido su familia en seguir a Jesús? ¿Cómo va a proveer?
How's he going to provide that?
It's called the
church,
la iglesia. Él está creyendo una familia que es más cerca de ti que los parientes de sangre.
He's creating a family for you that's closer to you than all of your blood relatives that don't know him.
Right? What's he doing for her? ¿Qué está haciendo para ella?
Él dice, mujer, ahí tú y.
Él dice, que yo amo. Aquí tu madre.
He looks at Mary and he says, there's your son.
Wait, that's not my son.
Yes, it is.
That's your son.
Why?
Because he's going to take care of you.
He's closer to you than a blood relative ever could be. Because you're both washed at feet.
So this is not my sin.
Bueno, eso es la gloria de Jesús en su sinodía.
This is the glory of Jesus in his sin.
Dying on the cross and doing this.
Well, eso es como un cordero, Jesús, en su simpatía divina. This is Jesus like a lamb in his divine sympathy.
Now, look at Jesus like a lion.
Eso es Jesús como un león en su soberanía.
This is Jesus like a lion in his sovereignty. Look at verses 28 and 29. Mira versículo 28 y 29.
Después de eso, sabiendo Jesús que todo se había ya consumado.
Five.
After this, knowing Jesus, that all things had been accomplished, finished.
¿Qué significa consumado?
What had been finished?
Prophecy.
Prophecy?
Do we have it up there?
Put that next to it.
Put that next to it.
Okay, finished. What's that word right there?
Telestai.
To telestai.
¿Qué significa eso?
¿Es una palabra en griego? ¿Qué significa?
What does it mean?
It's finished.
I thought possibly said it's Greek to me.
Okay.
Yes, it means it's finished. It's finished.
Eso es una palabra que está usado por los comerciantes para decir cuando una deuda ha sido pagado por completo.
This was used by merchants to, they stamped this. You can see it on receipts from this age. They stamped it and they said, paid in full for a debt that had been paid.
Así que Jesús sabía, porque él es Dios, él sabía que la deuda ha sido pagada.
What did he know?
The debt has been paid.
Now I have a question, what's the debt?
¿Qué es la deuda?
Pecado? ¿Qué es la paga de pecado?
What's the payment for sin?
Muerte. ¿Dónde dice eso? En la Biblia. Bueno. Yes, it says that in the Bible. It says in Romans 6:23. Look at Romans 6:23. Porque la paga del pecado es muerte. Romanos 6:23. Pero ¿qué significa muerte? What does death mean?
Does that mean I'm just going to die physically?
¿Qué significa muerte? Okay. La muerte espiritual. ¿Ustedes recuerdan cuando Jesús estaba orando en el jardín de Getsemaní?
You remember when Jesus is praying in the garden of Getsemaní?
Y él dijo eso. This is what he said. Padre mío, si es posible que pase de mí esta copa. Father, if it's possible, let this what pass from me? Cup. What's the cup?
La ira de Dios.
¿Cómo sabemos eso?
Bueno, muerte es lo que hay dentro de ese copa que Jesús tomó.
Whatever death is, it's whatever's inside this cup that Jesus is about to drink. Now, you want to know what the cup is, you all said the wrath of God, you're right. Here's what it says in the Bible in Revelation 14. Aquí es lo que dice para describir lo que es en la copa en Apocalipsis 14. Si alguien adora a la bestia en su imagen y se deja poner en la frente o en la mano la marca de la bestia, beberá también el vino del furor de Dios que en la copa de su ira está puro, no diluido. Será atormentado con fuego y azufre en presencia de los santos ángeles y del cordero. If anyone adores the beast in his image and puts the mark on his forehead or on his hand, he will drink of the wine of the wrath of the fury of the wine of the fury of God that is mixed in the cup, pure, undiluted. He will be tormented, fire and brimstone in presence of the holy angels and of the Lamb. That's what's in the cup. La ira de Dios puro.
It is the wrath of God undiluted in the cup. Escúchame bien. Jesús tragó esta copa hasta la última gotita en la cruz.
Jesus drank that cup down to the very last drop in the cross. That's what was happening when he was hanging there.
¿Qué sabía Jesús? Que la deuda ha sido pagada. Por eso, Pablo escribió en Colosenses 2, 13 a 14.
This is why Paul wrote in Colossians 2, 13 and 14. Listen to this. Sin embargo, Dios nos dio vida en unión con Cristo a perdonarnos todos los pecados y anular la deuda que teníamos pendiente por los requisitos de la ley. Él anuló esa deuda que nos era adversa clavándola en la cruz.
However, God gave us life in union with Christ, forgiving us our sins, having canceled the debt that was against us because of the requirements of the law.
¿Qué sabía Jesús? Él es un león, su soberanía. Él sabía la deuda ha sido pagada.
What did Jesus know in his divinity, in all of his divine power and authority and sovereignty? He knew the debt has been paid.
Pero aquí es otra cosa. Jesús sabía otra cosa. Para salvarnos, Él no solo tuvo que pagar mi deuda. Él tuvo que proveerme con la justicia que me paga.
To save me, listen to this. Here's your problem. You want to know what your problem is?
Like, I know what my problem is.
Well, here's what the Bible says your problem is. You not only have a debt to pay, you have no righteousness to present before God. Your debt is paid in Jesus, if you trust Him. But you need righteousness to present before God.
Tenemos una deuda, pero también necesitamos la justicia de Dios para entrar al cielo, así es.
Y por eso, Jesús tiene que cumplir toda la Escritura para cumplir la justicia que yo no puedo cumplir.
Jesus has to fulfill all of the Scripture to fulfill the righteousness that I don't have. And listen to me, there's one more thing He's got to fulfill.
Hay una cosa más que Él tiene que cumplir.
Mira aquí en Juan 19, 28, 29, dice, look at John 19, 28 to 29. Después de esto, sabiendo Jesús que todo se había ya consumado para que se cumpliera la Escritura, dijo, tengo sed. After this, knowing Jesus, that all had been accomplished, all had been fulfilled, in order to fulfill the Scripture, He said, I thirst.
Había ahí una vasija llena de vinagre, colocaron pues una esponja empapada de vinagre y una aroma de sopo, y se la acercaron a la boca.
So they take a sponge, they take a hyssop branch, and they dip it in the vinegar that's sitting there, and they lift it up to Him. He's only about 3 or 4 feet off the ground. They lift it up to Him, and He drinks it.
¿Por qué tomó Jesús ese vinagre?
Why did Jesus take that vinegar?
¿Qué piensas?
Why did He take it?
Por un último grito.
He took it so that He could cry out one more time. What's His last cry?
Consumado es! He said it. He took that vinegar one more time so that He could cry out, it's finished! It is finished now! It's finished!
Matthew 5:17, Jesus